Replace fear with the confidence to make sales. Developing offers, honing communication, building relationships, intentionally creating success for yourself, your customers, and your community. Join Corey Barrier and Callie Keene as they learn and share the exact strategies to harness ADHD into a superpower. Join us as we become sales legends.
All right, let's get rolling.
Yeah, let's get into it.
Does the sound sound good? Sounds great. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, great.
Yeah, man. Camera difficulties too.
Yeah, damn.
That's okay. I'm like, damn it! You know why? Because I waited to the last minute, right? Of course! Like, to the last minute. I'm like, I can do it. I have enough time. No.
I looked everywhere for that link.
Yeah, I don't know. Who knows? I probably forgot to send it. Story of our life, right? My life. So let's get into this. This is interesting, Callie, because rejection sensitivity is it is not scientifically proven. There's no studies of research on this exact topic. But
lots of
physicians, lots of doctors, lots of mental health people are professionals. Refer to this as these, and listen, I can explain it perfectly. It's, you know, when you're laying, for example, last night, I had, my wife and I have a shared bank account. Usually I'm the one that gives my wife money, right? It's just the way, I mean, not that she doesn't make her own money, but I just handle all the finances. And so last night I laid in bed. This is so stupid. I laid in bed and I'm like, gotta ask her for $10,000. Just to ask her now. No, just ask her in the morning. Okay, just, yeah, it'll probably be better tomorrow morning. Callie, I'm not even kidding you. This is the shit that my wife does not give a damn about writing me a check for whatever I asked for. Could care less. And I did this last night and I'm like, this is exactly what we're talking about. It's the wrestle back and forth in your head about something that's a stupid thought that you created, right?
Okay.
That whole scenario, it was fake. But up here, it was absolutely real.
Well, I think a lot of people struggle with that in general. But, you know, your ability to hop in and really imagine what somebody else is feeling and then think of all the different possible bad things that can happen. This leads us to a lot of very clear, very helpful, you know, mindset discussions. You know, I know you and I have gone in depth about different perspectives of this, and I don't know if anybody's following my content. I'm about to hurt a lot of people's feelings. I will tell you that, Corey. But there's a lot of truth to, you know, to being able to acknowledge that. So you're on the other side of it, right? And I want to draw a line with this to any of these behaviors that we're going to talk about or any of the tools that we're going to talk about, because there's excuse people, right? Yep. And then there's no excuse people, right? There's the people that are saying, I'm going to take this, and they're with our mission. I'm going to take this and I'm going to make it into my superpower, because I see what you're saying, and I see what people are saying about rejection sensitivity and how that would feed into emotional sensitivity and other issues. But once you see it, once you read about it and you can acknowledge it in yourself, so that's baseline emotional intelligence, right? We live in a society right now that's obsessed with, let's say, respecting other people's whatevers, or, you know, not walking on eggshells, not infringing on somebody's thoughts, beliefs, identities, and things like that. But the problem that I have is that emotional intelligence starts with acknowledging yourself first. What do I truly think? What do I truly feel? And when you can see that and say, man, I'm doing that thing with my wife again. Of course she wants to give me $10,000. It's our money and it's our success. She's going to reap the benefits of applying that $10,000. So of course she's going to want to invest in what Corey is doing. Of course she's going to want, but I'm doing that thing again where I'm imagining all the negative possibilities and I'm going to pull up those old thoughts where somebody didn't want to give me $10 for a sandwich or that time that I wasted $1,000, and you're misaligning and misimagining and pulling that past into the future. That, I mean, that's a lot of the way that trauma works and the way that your brain works anyways, right? But my point being is there's a lot of people out there that see that word, they see that term for ADHD, and they say, that's what it is. That's me. Well, I guess that's the way that I am. I guess I'm just a sensitive person. And I guess that my friend is just going to have to know that, and they're just going to have to deal with me. They're just going to have to deal with the fact that I'm insecure, that I feel this way, that I'm hurt, that I need this and I need that from them. And that's positive, but you will never become what you could possibly be until you get on the other side of it and say, you know what? I have a tendency. I lean towards this thing. So for me, I lean towards frustration. I talk about this a lot. Like I'm always like an 8 out of 10 with being frustrated. And sometimes I'm like a 9.9 out of frustration, you know, like it's just a little thing. And I'm like, I want to have a meltdown. And when I was younger, like that, I would just be in a full meltdown, right? Full tears, full, couldn't deal with anything because I was always so frustrated. And we can talk about that on another show, just the way that that really feeds in. But you can't get better. You can't become what you want to do what you want to do, have the relationships that you want to have, if you're willing to accept that.
That's right.
Yeah.
100%. And you said something vitally important. It's recognizing when that's happening, right? You got to say, then you got to look at it. But that's awareness. And then if you don't have awareness, then you probably don't recognize these things. But having that awareness is important, because then you can almost disassociate yourself from that idea, that thought. And I'll say this, you know, Ed, I got this from Ed. Ed said, you don't have to believe everything you think. Now, I think that's an extremely powerful statement, because mm-hmm. we do believe the craziness that goes on sometimes in our head, and it's not reality. It's just not. In sales, like, last night, I even said to myself, this is what you teach people to do, is overcome the fear of asking, but you're laying here wrestling with it. It doesn't make sense, but it's human nature that we pull back these negative experiences when it's time to do something uncomfortable. But recognizing that will get you on the other side.
Yeah, you've laid a great foundation for this talk. So I want you to really, for the people that are hard of listening, right, and that they're failing to connect the dots, I want you to drive this home for us, because really what we're doing is we're translating this information that we're learning about ourselves, learning about ADHD, learning how to turn those deficits into superpowers, and we're translating that information into sales, because we found there's a one-to-one correlation here. It's not like this is kind of related, but this is laser targeted. Every time we talk to somebody from Alive, in our community, from Clubhouse, number one, maybe number two thing that we talk about is this thing.
Yeah. Right?
Drive it home for me, brother. Like,
yeah.
When I'm trying to make a sale, I'm walking up to that person's house, I'm walking into the office. This is the same thing, right?
Same thing. Exactly. Oh, and think about this, right? Let's tie it right together. Tie it right to the very first thing that I teach people in my program is confidence, right? And this is what, and it's overcoming that fear, and confidence is where it kicks in. Now, I don't mean ego. I don't mean you have to be an asshole. You have, but confidence is something that you can transfer into the other person. Now, here's the other side of this, Callie. You can transfer that negative energy also into your customer.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, man.
And that is not going to help you. If you go into a meeting after you just found out your wife said she's leaving you, you're better off canceling that meeting and doing it another time, because your brain's not going to be there. You're going to transfer that worry, that scared feeling of, my wife's going to leave me, right into the guy you're trying to ask for money. And he's going to be, I don't want any part of this, right? Internally, he's going to think, subconsciously, he's going to pick up on it.
We've been on group meetings where somebody's pitched me, and then you've seen me pitch. And that has really been a big deal, is having that confidence and transferring that energy to somebody else. And for me, there's been tricks, and I will tell everyone that experience is the ultimate hack for confidence. It is. And if you're just getting started with something, understand that every time you are in that situation, you can look back and you can learn. And every time you win, you can look back and say, I've done this before. And you build a snowball effect that is unshakable confidence. But you can never get there without a little bit of rejection, without a little bit of experience and working. I'll say that first of all, that is real. That is, I can't tell you that there's a trick, a hack, a tip, or something that replaces solid experience. Like, that it would be a lie, right? But preparation, role playing, right? Knowing your numbers, coming in with a plan, knowing how an actual sales pitch is structured, knowing the objections that people are going to say, right? Knowing how to overcome those objections, knowing what they actually want, so you can tell them, I will do this for you. The outcome will be in this. We were in a pitch, and I told the guy exactly what I want right in the beginning. I said, here's the blue sky thing. Here's my experience. Here's my experience. Here's my experience. This is what I'm trying to achieve. Now, I want three things from you. How are you going to help me achieve it? How long is it going to take? And how much money is it going to cost? Now, let's hear your pitch. And then most of the time, right, people are like, because they're not ready to go. But what I'm doing for me, because I want to partner with the best people on the planet, right? I want to partner with the people that in their heart are trying to help people, and they're trying to get better, because I'm trying to get better. I'm trying to help people, and I'm transferring my energy, which is, we're going to do this, to that person. And if they can't absorb that energy and bring it back and say, I have confidence that I can be a member of that team, that I'm going to help you, we're going to do this together, it's a pass for me. It's a pass, right? And that's the same thing, Corey. I will tell you that right now, is that there's people on the flip side that they're looking for a partner. They're looking for a friend. They're looking for a collaborator. They need a web guy. They need a marketer. They need something. And they're afraid that they're too small, that they don't have enough money, that what they're doing is not cool enough. It's not sexy enough. And so they're just going to accept who's not going to reject them, who they can afford. And it's the same thing. It's the same thing, man, because if you're trying to hire the best, you're going to be pitching to be on their team. They can pay anybody that they want. So if you want to do something really amazing, you want to do a joint venture or collaboration, you've got to go in there, prepare, figure out what those people need, do all those things that Corey teaches about understanding who you're talking to, and you're changing that highlight reel in your brain.
And you hit on something vitally important. You said preparation. Now, oh, yeah. I can speak on that specifically, because this week, I'll tell you, full transparency, I pitched it. It was a $54,000 proposal. Here's the thing. It's not like I don't know my shit, right? I absolutely know my shit. Here's the issue. And I didn't think it all the way through. And so what happened is I decided, well, I don't write very good proposals. You know this. We've been through this 100 times. I'm just not great at it. And so therefore, I hired somebody to do that. What happened is it looked great. The proposal looked great. I read through it once. Here's the problem. I know me, and I needed to read it through that 5 or 6 times. I needed to make sure I understood where role the play. Parts were. Role play. Right?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And that way I could confidently go through that proposal. And here's what happened. I didn't confidently go through it because I fumbled, because it was new information. And so it was just worded in a slightly different way than I would have normally worded it. a better way, to be honest. And I don't feel like I did very good. Lesson here is that was a $54,000 lesson that you need to freaking prepare, Corey. Like, you got to think this through. And it wasn't like I didn't hear this time. My schedule truly got booked all the way out until the meeting. So I literally didn't have the time to do it.
Yep.
And I didn't have the time to think. And that's not good for people like me.
Yeah. And to give everybody, like, you know, frame of reference, Corey's a master sales trainer, right? And now as we've been working together, we've seen other opportunities that are, they're honestly, they're 10X opportunities, right? And so they don't require a sales sheet. They require a proposal, very customized for that person. It's a different kind of pitch. It's a different, the sales process is similar, but it's why, and Corey's watched me do this before, is people pitch us all the time. And then I ask them, I say, just email me a proposal. 1 in 100 people email me anything. And I heard Dan Fleshman talk about this too, because people were talking about pitching their startup. And he says, yeah, send me a pitch deck, and people don't do it. And I thought, man, Dan's smart, but I learned that a long time ago. But it's because they're used to selling services and say, hey, I'll give you monthly SEO services. Hey, I'll train you to do this program. And nobody cares. At a certain level, like, those are vehicles and no one cares. And to get that transfer of confidence, you have to build a proposal. It could just be one page or two pages, but it's a different game. So as we're moving through, this is something I'm super comfortable with, because this is what I do, and I'm not as comfortable with what Corey does. So we just change notes all the time, because I'm not used to saying, okay, well, it's, you know, $2,500 or $5,000 a month for coaching this and this and this. I'm used to saying, oh, it's going to be 6 months or 18 months. This project's going to be, and here's this proposal for it. That's just my universe, totally different thing, but it's the same thing. Right. And so, to bring this home into sales, what I want to say is it's that preparation, it's the role playing, but then I want to counterbalance this and say, you need to find a person that does what you want to do, right? So if you're a coach and you're in this group, like, it makes sense. We'll talk to Corey. He's a coach. He already does this, right? He does it at a high level. So if you wanted to learn how to get clients and learn how to know what to talk to them about every week and learn how to bring them through a process and charge what you're worth and that kind of stuff, that's what Corey already knows how to do, right? So you should be role playing with him. And that's, for me, that's the benefit, is like, okay, let's see, this is a different perspective. This is a different game. I'm going to collaborate with Corey and we're going to role play through this. We're going to think through this problem. I'm going to help him with his clients and I'm going to see what that looks like. And then conversely, if he wants to do consulting, which is what I do, and see what the sales process look like, that, like, we can role play on that side. So we can learn from each other. And what you need to do, this group is growing really quickly. Right. If you're watching this on YouTube, you're listening to this on the podcast, maybe you're like, what group is Callie talking about? Well, I'm talking about our Facebook group, ADHD Sales Legends, which I think we've broken 300 people. When this pops up, there you go. Corey's putting the link across the screen. Really simple. Facebook.com/groups/Sales Legends. So first of all, it's free to join. And Corey's putting videos in there all the time, but what we really want this group to be is a community. So you look at what other people are doing. A lot of ADHD coaches in there, a lot of sales professionals in there. And you need to find somebody that every day you can get on, Facebook Messenger, your text message, you can get on phone, you can get on a Zoom with, and you can set that cadence to practice. That's going to give you crazy level of confidence. That's going to give you that person that you can grow with. It's going to give you that accountability, and that's going to put the stupid rejection thoughts into perspective. Hey, this person that's doing great thinks I'm great. I must be pretty good. Well, I'm going to talk to them about the way that I felt. How did that go? dude, don't even worry about it. Those people don't deserve to work with you. It wasn't a good fit. Don't spend a bunch of time on that. You need to spend time on selling the people that are going to love you. Let's move on to the next thing. You need that accountability and you need that collaboration. I want everybody to look at the group and say, yeah, I need to find that partner.
Absolutely. And you know, here's the thing, Callie, let's go back for a second to the meeting with people on Zoom and maybe even going live with them. So that's kind of what I heard when you said, I don't even know if mm-hmm. you said go live with them. Did you say that?
I think people should, because in all honesty, you can be great on paper, but if you can think on your feet, one, you're going to really harness the power of ADHD, right? Is if you can stream of consciousness, you can get that background of the actual things you should be doing and then use that stream of consciousness to just like this. Corey records all of our meetings because sometimes we just say stuff. We're like, what? We got to remember that. And we won't. So like, we got to watch the replay. But I think that even if it's just between them, they should.
Yeah. I mean, because like you said, like, and look, I understand that if you're watching this and when you're listening to this, you really might be thinking we've lost our minds. I'm telling you, I promise you, and Kelly will agree with this. I know that this going live and being on the spot, it does something for your confidence because you're exposed, right? You're exposed to the world. And so when you get exposed to the world, that can feel very uncomfortable, right? It can feel like I don't want people in. I don't want to let people in or whatever that thought process is, but you will get better. I promise you, you have to. Like it's impossible for you not to get better if you do this thing. If you go live with somebody, whoever it is, and just have a conversation. Doesn't matter.
Yeah, dude, I think you should put out a mini course that's on gaining confidence in speaking, right? Mm. And you really should, and you should break it down for people of how you do it and how you've done it, because you're putting out reels all the time in your car, in the office, in your garage. You're getting on Zooms with people all the time. And when we talk to people in this community and in the past, they want to go from never sold a thing, trying to sell stuff, right? Hitting that friction to I'm going to go into somebody's house and I'm going to sell them a $20,000 plumbing job.
Right.
And I'm like, I'm going to be honest with you. That's a pretty big jump, man. You've never talked to somebody in a professional way in your life. And then you're going to say, I'm going to build a coaching practice where I'm going to sell hundreds of people my product. That's a pretty big jump, bro. Like, maybe you should hop on a few Zooms and do a couple lives first or start a podcast or something like that, right? Yes. I don't know.
Yeah, because you don't want to practice on your customers. That's for sure. Because if you do, right, you're going to lose customers. And I had another thought. It'll come back to me. I don't remember what it was. But, you know, Facebook Lives, I'll be honest, that's what got me started. A friend of mine, his name is Zal, he challenged me to a 30-day Facebook Live challenge. And I almost had a meltdown, dude. I was sweating. I paced. I started the thing. I stopped the thing probably 30 times. Mm-hmm. And guess what? You know, in my head, this is what was going to happen. This is how great I think I am. I'm going to have so many people on there commenting that it's going to distract me. I think I had two people on the whole 45-minute live.
Yeah.
And I don't think anybody commented.
People are like, everybody's going to make fun of me. I'll be like, dude, if people are making fun of you, you've jumped over the first hurdle of this where nobody's watching you.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
You must have 100%. Pretty good content that's capturing enough people's attention where they're making fun of you. Because honestly, like three people are going to look at your lives. And that's another skill that you're going to hop up to that we can talk about in sales and marketing and get yourself out there. But let's just talk about communication and overcoming that fear of rejection. So you're overcoming that little fear of rejection, that sensitivity towards it, because you think, hey, somebody's not going to like what I have to say.
And it's just, yeah. And look, most of the time we take it so personally. Like if we don't close a deal, if we miss something, right? We we think that it's our fault, right? And maybe it is to a degree, but at the end of the day, lots of times we do take things so personally that have really nothing to do with us, right? If we go, if we pitch somebody a deal, maybe they just don't have the money, or maybe that, you know, maybe they lied to you. Maybe there's all kinds of reasons why that didn't go through. You know what I mean?
Yeah. You got to use your superpower of forgetting stuff to forget every time that you don't get a sale.
Right. And try not to play those negative experiences over and over in your head, because it's really not beneficial. It's just not.
Yeah, man, this could lead to so many different topics. It's just great. I like it. We'll have to think about that kind of communication mini course and what that might look like and structure that, because this is a funny thing. And I'll say this about rejection as well, is there's a couple of framing ways that I look at it. And we talked about the experience piece. You'll hear everybody talks about that, right? But it's true. It's like, you're getting better. As long as you can get better every time and you can draw up mentally on those past successes and why you can help somebody win, like, your confidence will jump up and it won't be as big of a deal when you're rejected, because it's just an alignment issue, right?
Exactly.
They're not aligned with you. But let me give one key other little mental metaphor here. And people get freaked out with this. They get freaked out as they think, like, okay, I need to have a group of 20,000 people. I need to have 10,000 people. I need to run an ad for thousands of dollars. What if they don't like me? What if they don't have, you know, I'm going to go in, here's 100 mattress companies in this area. And like, what if this guy doesn't like me? What, you know, they're in sales and they look at it like every single piece. If I don't make this sale, or I need to get like this much positivity out of it. But then when we map it mathematically, right? So unemotionally, and you can do this like back of the envelope math. If you're an Excel wizard, use Excel, but look at it and say, okay, well, here's all the potential customers. Here's everybody that's on my list. Here's all the people I'm supposed to call and all the leads that I'm supposed to call. So what does 1% look like? What does 5% look like? What does 10%, 30% look like? And you start to realize really, really quickly that out of the potential, the total addressable market or the total reachable, serviceable market that's in your area, that's within your community, you can't even service but a tiny fraction of those people. And so while you're obsessed with rejection, you're already rejecting your success and the help that you're going to provide for 99% of the people, because you could only ever work with 5% of the people you have to reach to. And even if you have no social presence, this is the case. And we're going to teach you how in later episodes, how to reach out and use other influencers as channels and gain confidence through them, and how to get super, super targeted in the way that you go after opportunities. But you really look at it and you look at the math behind this, you realize that you have to be rejected. You have to be misaligned, because otherwise you can't handle the level of possibilities that are open to you in this world. Corey, if you said, I just want to service people that are owner-operated plumbing companies where the guy is over 55 and looking to retire in 10 years in the state of North Carolina or within 50 miles of my house, you couldn't coach and consult with all those companies.
No way.
You couldn't coach and consult with a quarter of those possibilities. And that's so focused. You couldn't handle that level of success. If you're just starting or you're under 8 figures, most likely you can't handle the level of success that's already available to you. And you're getting tripped up because somebody who doesn't need what you're selling said, I'll pass.
That's it. Exactly. And here, you know, I want to drive one more quick point home. I don't, and I've run across this a lot. If you have knowledge. If Kelly has knowledge that I don't have, right? It doesn't matter what the knowledge is. It doesn't matter. And you can measure it on as far as revenue, if that's what you so choose to do. Or you could, you also could measure it as, sorry, I got distracted. My point is this, you should get paid for your knowledge. And if you have knowledge that somebody else doesn't have, you got to figure out what that's worth to them. You got to figure out, what is that going to do for their life? How is it going to change their outcome? And how is it going to change the rest of their life? These tools, these skills that you give people, if you work with other ADHD people, that you're giving them is going to be massive in their life. And it's going to change the direction of their life. Can you imagine if I would have known that all the things that we're finding out now, 30 years ago, 20 years ago, what life would be like? I mean, I don't reminisce about it. I believe that I'm right here right now because I'm supposed to be right here right now. And I'm supposed to find this out right here right now. And so it wouldn't have done any good for me to find it out 15 years ago because I probably wouldn't have understood it. I understand it now. This was the perfect time for me to understand what's going on in my life. So that's extremely valuable to me to understand why I do the things that I do, because then I don't kick myself in the ass because of, you know, forgetting something or my camera not working or, you know, technical difficulties or whatever the case may be. My point is you're worth exactly what you're doing for the other person. You got to measure that in a really succinct way. You have to measure the amount of time that you're spending with people. You have to measure. I mean, look, you think about this. If you're in a text conversation with someone and it's eating up 2 hours a day of your time, you got to look at that. I mean, that means that there's a lot of work to be done in that relationship, and you've got to protect yourself because, Callie, you know, this people will burn up your time just because they want to have a conversation about what kind of damn cigars I smoke. I'm like, absolutely not. No, that's not what we're talking about.
Yeah, so this isn't a knitting circle, right? This is coaching.
Right. I mean, and look, I think that if you're not confident in what you're selling, and I see this a lot, then maybe it's that maybe you need to do some more research. Maybe you got to plan out what you're doing a little bit better. Back to the preparation. Preparation's key. And if you go into it knowing what that person needs, it's a massive difference in the result. Massive. It changes the game.
I could not agree more. So that's our takeaway for this week is we're incoming and our issue is sensitivity to rejection. A lot of people, even if you don't have ADHD, a lot of people focus on this. Certainly everyone that starts in sales focuses on this. They have this issue. And how can we tamp that down? How can we overcome that thing? Well, number one is preparation. And we can prepare a couple of different ways. We can prepare by having experience, knowing our numbers, having a good pitch or a proposal or offer dialed in. But on the soft side, soft skills of things, you can practice with somebody. You can build a relationship with somebody that you can role play with. And these are all things that we talk about all the time. These are all things that are you coach on, but don't just get stuck. And this is my final word on this. Don't just look and go to a WebMD or wherever you're getting information and use one of these symptoms as an excuse. Use it as a waypoint to then say, what are the tools that I need? What are the practices and habits that I need to hone this in? Because that same sensitivity is a thing that will help you have a superpower of reading your customer, understanding how they feel about that pitch, understanding that you really need to overcome not their objections, but their fears, their sensitivities, and make it not just a maybe we'll consider it, but a hell yes. Because the way that you feel is probably a similar way that they feel, or they feel like maybe they're too small for you. You can't do the thing, and that they're drowning and they really need help, that they're overwhelmed. Maybe they feel frustrated because you're the sixth person that's pitched them the exact same thing, and they're thinking, this is another person that's just going to take my money, can't help me, and I need help. So once you turn that inward focus, you acknowledge it, and you put the tools and practices and habits in place to make that better for yourself, you can then turn that into a superpower by focusing on, well, how does my customer feel? Well, they feel the same way as you because you're both humans. So if you can acknowledge that, you can change the way that you do sales. So it's a human to human approach. I guarantee you that you'll make more money, but I guarantee that the real deal, you'll have customers that are more aligned to you. The impact and the service that you provide will be unparalleled. You'll achieve your mission. We call it mission, right? This is the fulfillment. It's the way you feel about yourself. And that feeds into the whole system. You feel more confident, right? So that's just my piece to this is like, don't get hung up on any of the things that we talk about that's you. It's not your identity. It's your situation. You can change your situation.
Absolutely.
All right.
And Kelly, I want to wrap. Yeah, let's just wrap this up. Because the last thing I want to say is, you know, put yourself in the other person's shoes, right? If you're talking to somebody else that's new to coaching, that's new to ADHD, they're scared as fuck. Like, they're scared, right? They're nervous as shit, just like you are, right? It's the same thing. So if you can help them feel better in that situation, you're going to be able to help them a lot easier because they're going to be willing to work with you because they understand that you understand them. And that's vitally important. That's what I've got.
Thank you, everybody, for listening. And look, we are building a very powerful community. It is focused on sales. It is focused on people that have ADHD. And it is a great place to connect. I know that I already mentioned it, but I'm going to mention it again because maybe you forgot, right? Maybe you're so wrapped up in all the hot fire that Corey was spitting, the knowledge that I was trying to drop, is that you forgot that you should go to Facebook and join our community, right? And that's where a lot of the content lives. That's where Corey's putting a lot of content out, like I'd say every day or almost every day. And we have people joining every day. So if you look up ADHD Sales Legends, or you go to facebook.com/groups/sales legends, you'll find us. You can join totally free. Won't ask you for a bunch of dumb things or harass you about this or that, but it's a way to get in on our live streams. It's a way to get that additional content. And as we develop those mini courses and cheat sheets and little extra bonuses and pieces, like that's where they're going to live. So, I know that for a select group of people, this is super helpful. If you're one of those people, browse in there, join us. I'll see you on the inside. But that's it for me. Thanks, brother.
Yeah, it's been great. Yep. Thanks, everybody, for watching. We appreciate it.